Blackstone Publishing presents The Trip to Echo Spring on Writers and Drinking by Olivia Laing. This book is read by Kate Redding. For my mother, Denise Laing, with all my love. When alcoholics do drink, most eventually become intoxicated, and it is this recurrent intoxication that eventually brings their lives down in ruins. Friends are lost, health deteriorates, marriages are broken, children are abused, and jobs terminated. Yet despite these consequences, the alcoholic continues to drink. Many undergo a change in personality. Previously upstanding individuals may find themselves lying, cheating, stealing, and engaging in all manner of deceit to protect or cover up their drinking. Shame and remorse the morning after may be intense. Many alcoholics progressively isolate themselves to drink undisturbed. An alcoholic may hole up in a motel for days or a week, drinking continuously. Most alcoholics become more irritable. They have a heightened sensitivity to anything vaguely critical. Many alcoholics appear quite grandiose, yet on closer inspection, one sees that their self-esteem has slipped away from them. Handbook of Medical Psychiatry, edited by David P. Moore and James W. Jefferson.
Easy, easy, Mr. Bones. Eyes on your side.
Dream Song 36, John Berryman. 1. Echo Spring. Here's a thing. Iowa City, 1973. Two men in a car, a Ford Falcon convertible that's seen better days. It's winter, the kind of cold that hurts bones and lungs, that reddens knuckles, makes noses run. If you could, by some devoted act of seeing, crane in through the window as they rattle by, you'd see the older man, the one in the passenger seat, has forgotten to put on his socks. He's wearing penny loafers on bare feet, oblivious to the cold, like a prep school boy on a summer jaunt. In fact, you could mistake him for a boy. Slight, in Brooks Brothers tweeds and flannel trousers, his hair immaculately combed. Only his face betrays him, collapsed into hangdog folds. The other man is bigger, burlier, 35. Sideburns, bad teeth, a ragged sweater open at the elbow. It's not quite 9 a.m. They turn off the highway and pull into the parking lot of the state liquor store. The clerk's out front, keys glinting in his hand. Seeing him, the man in the passenger seat yanks the door and lurches out. Never mind the car's still moving.
By the time I got inside the store, the other man will write, a long time later, he was already at the checkout stand with half a gallon of scotch.
They drive away, passing the bottle back and forth. Within a few hours, they'll be back at the University of Iowa, swaying eloquently in front of their respective classes. Both are, as if it isn't obvious, in deep trouble with alcohol. Both are also writers, one very well known, the other just cresting into success. John Cheever, the older man, is the author of three novels, The Wapshot Chronicle, The Wapshot Scandal, and Bullet Park, as well as some of the most miraculous and distinctive stories ever written. He's 61. Back in May, he was rushed to hospital with dilated cardiomyopathy, testament to the almighty havoc alcohol wreaks upon the heart. After 3 days in the intensive care unit, he developed delirium tremens, becoming so violently disturbed he had to be secured with a leather straitjacket. The job at Iowa, a semester teaching at the famous writer's workshop, must have seemed like a passport to a better life, though it isn't quite panning out that way. For various reasons, he's left his family behind. living like a bachelor in a single room at the Iowa House Hotel. Raymond Carver, the younger man, has also just joined the faculty. His room is identical to Cheever's, and immediately beneath it. The same painting hangs on both their walls. He's come alone too, leaving his wife and teenaged children in California. All his life he's wanted to be a writer, and all his life he's felt circumstance set hard against him. The drinking's been going on for a long while, but despite its depredations, he's managed to produce 2 volumes of poetry and to build up quite a clutch of stories, many of them published in little magazines. At first glance, the two men seem polar opposites. Cheever looks and sounds every inch the moneyed wasp, though closer acquaintance reveals this to be a complex kind of subterfuge. Carver, on the other hand, is a mill worker's son from Klatskanai, Oregon, who spent years supporting his writing with menial jobs as a janitor, a stock boy, and a cleaner. They met on the evening of 30 August, 1973. Cheever knocked on the door of room 240, holding out a glass and announcing, according to John Jackson, a student who was present at the time,
"Pardon me, I'm John Cheever. Could I borrow some scotch?"
Carver, elated to meet one of his heroes, stutteringly held out a vast bottle of Smirnoff. Cheever accepted a slug, though he turned his nose up at the embellishments of ice or juice. Sensing a dual intersection of interests, the two men immediately bonded. They spent much of their time together in the mill bar, which only served beer, talking about literature and women. Twice a week they drove out in Carver's Falcon to the liquor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.